Hello everybody and welcome back to the second shelf and to the first recent reads on Sunday in the new year in 2019. For those of you who might be new to the channel, and I have quite some new subscribers, so welcome. I'm happy to have you on every other Sunday. Sometimes three times a month I do a recent reads, which means I discuss books with you that I read in the 2 weeks or so before the video. And I didn't do, 2019 goals video or something like that, but I wanted to tell you that I started a new book project in January. I just finished my novel, and while waiting for the editor to completely crush it, I'll keep myself busy with a new project, a nonfiction project, in which I look at certain themes in books by female writers, especially recent ones, but I also go to the backlist. So that's why this week's reads, or this Sunday recent reads, all center around relationships. But enough of the preliminaries, let's get into the books. The first book I read in 2019 was a book that got quite some hype and attention last year. It was published in the beginning of 2018, and that is Tayari Jones' An American Marriage. I didn't get to the book last year, and I thought it might be a good way to start off my reading in 2019. Now, Tayari Jones is a Black American writer. She was born in Atlanta, and many of her books are set in the South. I read only one of her novels previously, The Silver Sparrow, and I quite liked it. I wasn't in love with it, but I quite liked it. So I was looking forward to her new one, An American Marriage, but right up front, because a lot of people love this book, it was not for me. An American Marriage centers, as the title indicates, around a marriage. We have Celestial and Roy, a youngish couple, newlywed, just a year and a half, living in the South, in Atlanta. Roy is making a career in the corporate world as an executive, and Celestial is an artist just on the verge of a breakthrough. So it's a successful, young couple. And then, of course, tragedy strikes, because Roy is arrested. He is charged with rape. And then the book follows the time that Roy is in prison. There are letters from Roy to Celestial and Celestial to Roy. What happens to their marriage while Roy is imprisoned, innocently imprisoned, I should stress, and what happens after he is released. Now, I expected, I think, something different. First of all, I expected that the major theme of the book would be racial injustice in the United States. So, is a Black man being incarcerated innocently, and that would be the focus of the book. But no. I was very disappointed about that, because that theme is actually more or less just, mentioned in a by the way, and is not explored in any depth. And I was also, I couldn't relate to the way that the marriage was depicted. I wrote in my Goodreads review that if I had known better, the book is set in the present time, if I had known better, I would have thought that the book was set in the 1950s. Because it's such a, for me, old-fashioned way of describing men and women and the relationship. There is another man in the picture, Andre, who is a longtime friend of Celestial's, and then the two men fight about the woman, and I think, what a da? Anyway, so it was not for me. The main theme disappointed me, because I expected more, and the relationship description or the way the relationship was portrayed, I thought was just not anything that I would want to read about now. But like I said, many, many people love this book. So let me know down in the comments whether you are one of those and what you especially loved about the book. The next book I picked was shortlisted for the Costa First Novel Award. Unfortunately, it didn't win it, but it caught my interest when I saw it on the shortlist, and that's this one, Natalie Hart, Pieces of Me. It was published last year, and Natalie Hart is a UK writer and researcher. She specializes in post-conflict topics. She spent a lot of time in the Middle East writing about conflict areas, and the book is set partly in Colorado and partly in Iraq. We have Adam, an American soldier, and we have Emma, his new wife. She is British, and they meet when they are both in Iraq, Adam as a soldier and Emma as a refugee worker, I call it. She works for an agency dealing with asylum applications from Iraqi people who want to go to the US. The book is structured in three parts, before the deployment of Adam back to Iraq, during the employment and deployment, and after the deployment. But there is a lot of backstory in those three parts, because as I said, Adam and Emma meet while they're both in Iraq, and then they fall in love, they marry, they go back to the US, and they live in Colorado, and then Adam is deployed again to Iraq while Emma stays in Colorado. So it's a complicated marriage situation, and I really enjoyed this book, and I especially liked the very layered and nuanced picture it gave of the life in Iraq, because a lot of the book is telling us the story while Emma is still in Iraq, living there, and how much she loves the country. It's also a very layered portrayal of the life of soldiers' wives when Emma is back in the US, and it's not cliched at all. So the marriage suffers from Adam's deployment, and especially when he comes back. But it gives a full picture of the life of soldiers, but also a picture of Iraqi people who are looking for refuge in the US. So it's really multi-layered and very well written, very well told. It's not a flawless book, but it's a debut novel. So I think it's very much worth your attention if you haven't heard of it. Pieces of Me by Natalie Hart. I can highly recommend it. The next marriage book I read was a new release, Susan Conley, Elsie, Come Home. And no, it's not a sequel of Three Things You Have to Know About Elsie. But I don't know why she picked this name, because a lot of people will think about that book. Anyway, Susan Conley is an American writer and teacher. She lives in Portland, I think. She's written previous novels, but I haven't read any of her work. So this was my first encounter with Susan Conley. Elsie Come Home is set in Beijing. And it's about an expat marriage. We have Lucas, who is from Denmark, and his American wife, Elsie, who live in Beijing, and they have two young daughters. And Elsie, we learn that right from the start when the book opens, obviously has a drinking problem. She was ill, she had a surgery, but the recovery from the surgery is not really the reason we learn that she started drinking. She doesn't work anymore, she lies on the sofa most of the time and drinks. And Lucas puts an ultimatum to her that she has to go on a one-week retreat, a yoga retreat in the mountains in the north, I think, of Beijing. Most of the book then is about those 10 days or 7 days in that yoga retreat and the people Elsie meets There is May, who is a famous Chinese artist. We have people, you know, from executive corporate background. So quite a variety of people in that group. And then there's a little part at the end when Elsie comes home after the retreat. It's not a bad book. I mean, it's well written. The atmosphere is really good. It's sort of a bit of a stream of consciousness book because we stay in Elsie's head throughout the book. But I just didn't like it very much. I found it boring, which could be because I'm not that interested in, you know, the details of a yoga retreat. That might be the reason why. But if the subject appeals to you, and keep in mind, like I said, main portion of the book is set in that yoga retreat, then it might be something for you. And as I said, the beginning of this video, I'm focusing on newish releases 2018-2019 for this topic of marriage and relationship, but I also read backlist books. And the first backlist book I read is by one of my favorite authors, and that's Meg Wolitzer's The 10-Year Nap, which was published 10 years ago in 2008, almost 11 years ago. Meg Wolitzer doesn't need an introduction. You know, if you're following my channel for any length of time, that I really love her work. Her latest, The Female Persuasion, was one of my first 5-star reads last year. I love the interestings. And if you haven't seen the movie The Wife with Glenn Close as the wife of the Nobel Prize winner, go see it. I thought it was really good. But anyway, this is an older book of Meg Wolitzer's set in 2006-ish, and we follow a group of women friends centering around one character, Amy, who's married to Leo. Leo is a lawyer. Amy was a lawyer as well, but then their son was born and 10 years ago, and Amy quit working. But we also learn a lot about Amy's background, her family, especially Antonia, her mother, who was your typical, you know, 1960s housewife, and then decided that she wants a career and started writing historical fiction novels, and quite successfully so. And then you have Amy's group of friends. Most of them quit working when the children came, but not all of them. And in the typical Meg Wolitzer style, I mean, she can handle, like I said on Goodreads, she can handle a big cast of characters like nobody else. All the characters are treated with depth and individuality, even the minor ones. We learn a lot about Amy's life in New York. I should have said the book is set in New York, and how the marriage suffers because there's not a lot of money now that Amy quit working, and whether she should go back to work, how women she meets, you know, mothers of her son's school friends, how they deal with either working or not working. So it's really a very panoramic view of the state of marriage and motherhood in the early 2000s. Yeah, let's say mid the first half of the decade of the new millennium, and in the typical, you know, very subtly humorous style of Meg Wolitzer that I love so much. So if you haven't read this one, it's such a joy to experience, and I can certainly recommend this. And the last book I want to talk to you about on this recent reads on Sunday is a nonfiction work by the English author Deborah Levy, The Cost of Living, which was published in 2018. Now, Deborah Levy is, I think, most famous or known for her latest novel, Hot Milk, which was on the shortlist for the Man Booker in 2016. But she not only writes novels, she's also a playwright and a poet, and she writes nonfiction. This one, The Cost of Living, is the second installment in her work called Autobiography or Working Autobiography, and it's a slim little book, under 200 pages, dealing with she starts the book, I should say, the point in time when her marriage of almost 20 year crumbles and she separates. And shortly after that, within the same year, also her mother dies. So the book is thematically centered around Livy's attempt to find a new way of living. She has two daughters. One is still living with her. The other is off to college. She wants to write, and she doesn't have the space to write because, you know, in the apartment there is no space for her. So it's that sort of reflection you might think of Virginia Woolf's A Room of One's Own, and that's true, but it's not only about writing, it's also about the marriage and how why and how it failed. It's about the grief of her mother's death, but also about the difficult relationship between mother and daughter. And even though those are all very heavy subjects, if you know Deborah Levy's work, you know that she has this way of always inserting a humorous pun when it's getting very heavy. And she does that here as well, intelligently, with these one-liners that are so quotable, but you know, intelligently quotable. I love this book. It was my first 5-star read of this year, and it happened really early, so in the first 2 weeks of January. I'm happy about that. And if you are interested in this sort of memoir autobiography centering around themes like motherhood, womanhood, living alone, writing, dealing with grief, then this is certainly something for you. So this was it for the first Sunday, the first recent reads on Sunday for this year. Thank you very much for watching. Again, welcome if you are a new subscriber. I'm happy to have you. As always, I'm looking forward to your comments. Talk to me down in the comments about these books or any other books. And I'll see you all soon in the next one. Bye-bye.